And so this is a very typical chart from a large children's hospital, and it describes children from a range of ages, and it makes suggestions about the recommended carbohydrate amount per age of child. And you can see that if you had a boy in between 9 and 13 years of age, that you're asked to feed this boy 60 grams of carbohydrates for breakfast, 75 grams for lunch, 15 for a snack, 75 for dinner, and an evening snack of 15 grams. And so where does this come from? This comes from the AMDR. I don't have time to get into this. If you're interested, go to the YouTube video from last year's talk. But as it turns out, the Institute of Medicine prescribes these amounts of macronutrients, and our dietitians in major children's hospitals around the country follow them with very few exceptions. And so that's 45 to 65% carbohydrates in your macronutrients, and 25 to 35% fat. So what does that actually look like? Well, in a person who lives with type 1 diabetes, they would, of course, have to take some basal insulin. That's the amount of insulin that they need just to keep going to ensure that they're not breaking down fat. They need some basal insulin dripping in their bodies. They would take a very long-acting form of insulin or have a pump that would do this. And then they would wake up in the morning. This boy would consume 60 grams of carbohydrates, get a couple of units of insulin, and then 75 grams, and then 105 grams. And then the hope is that blood glucose would stay in a steady range, and everything would be nice and smooth. And many endocrinologists believe that it will work if you simply follow our prescriptions. So they think that the major limitation in between these ideal blood sugars and outcomes is simply a patient's ability to follow very precisely the instructions from the medical team. I'm here to tell you that it's much more complicated than that. And sadly, a much more likely scenario is that people have these wild excursions with huge ups and downs in blood sugars, these sine waves. And you can imagine what it's like to have a blood sugar of 350 and be on the downward slope of a roller coaster and wondering if you're going to actually crash down into the ground. And that tear just completely disrupts some people's lives. And so I'm going to show you some actual patient data that describes this. So this is data from a continuous glucose monitor. It happens to be the Dexcom, but there are several brands on the market. And what we're doing here is actually looking at the interstitial glucose, not blood glucose, but it's roughly the same thing, of an 18-year-old who's had type 1 diabetes for more than 10 years. And this is a high-carb day. And you can see that this person is rising up and down with a ton of volatility. And just, again, imagine yourself around 7 o'clock wondering if you're going to crash out. And by the way, if blood glucose goes below 50 or 40 milligrams per deciliter, they could go unconscious. So it strikes a lot of terror in the people who live with type 1. And you can also see the rebound hyperglycemia afterwards. So that's reflected in the standard deviation, not just in the average blood glucose. This person is sitting with an average glucose of around 200, but the standard deviation is 90, so a lot of volatility, a lot of flux, a lot of variance. And the time in range is relatively low. 40% of this day is spent out of the ideal range. Okay, are there innovative dietary interventions for type 1 diabetes? And thankfully, the answer is yes. So, in short, eat more protein and fat. It's just that simple. And it makes an enormous difference. And so I described the Institute of Medicine, the so-called AMDR, the acceptable macronutrient distribution range of a very high percentage of carbohydrates with some protein and some fat. But the obvious answer is to simply swap this out with a more logical regimen. If carbohydrate is the macronutrient that you can't effectively metabolize or cover with insulin, eat less. So what am I talking about? In this case, this would be a low-carb, high-protein diet, which would have a bunch of protein and a bunch of fat. And this is what happens if you eat, for instance, a ribeye steak and some vegetables on the side. Another alternative is to actually go to a low-carb, high-fat diet. And there are others who deliberately pursued this with a semi-normal amount of protein, maybe a little bit more, and a lot of fat. And we'll talk about some of the nuances of this. I call this is low-carb, high-fat, or nutritional ketosis. So what does this look like? Well, you're still going to need your basal insulin. That's not going to change. But you might consume 20 grams of protein, a couple of eggs in the morning, and have a very small bolus, and then 25 grams in the middle of the day, and then 35 grams in the evening. So this would be this 10-year-old child I talked about before, and ideally blood sugars would sit in a very normal range throughout the day. And if that were true, that'd be very exciting. And then presumably you'd be able to have blood sugars that, again, are in the normal range for a lot of the day, thus reducing the variability and allowing people to just breathe and feel like they're more human. So I showed you this tracing of the 18-year-old who's had type 1 diabetes for 10 years and all the volatility. Let's look at the same person on a low-carb day. It's just a dramatic difference. And being able to predict where you're going to be means that the math test that you have in the afternoon, or the job interview, or the date that you have in the evening, or a drive down the highway isn't associated with terror and anxiety, but it can allow you to simply live life.